you know that driving is the most dangerous activity that most people do at work? It's estimated that 25 to 30% of road fatalities are in accidents involving somebody who is working. Of all work-related deaths, about 75% occur on the road.
To help you drive safely at work, we're going to look at why accidents happen. See what you need to do to stay safe, including avoiding fatigue and distractions. Help you to not drink and drive. Show you what to do if you do have an accident. Touch on how to be safe if your work involves spending most of your day in the car.
Statistically, when you drive for work, you're more likely to have an accident.
There's no definitive reason why. It may be that you feel under more pressure, that you have to drive long distances on monotonous roads, or that you have to drive when you wouldn't really choose to, and you have to get up early to make a meeting or drive at night to make a delivery.
The most common causes of witness road accidents are careless driving, drink driving, and speeding.
Click next to look at one of the key contributors to careless driving. Fatigue.
What do you think? Which of these statements about fatigue-related accidents are true?
What is the status of this
estimated that staying awake for 17 to 19 hours just under the legal limit in the UK. 24 hours awake can result in impairments equivalent to 0.1% over the legal limit.
Fatigue-related accidents are usually high speed. They are more likely to result in a fatality or serious injury because the driver is less likely to have tried to slow down or avoid a collision.
Concentration, short-term memory, and judgment are impaired, which is why tired drivers tend to think they're okay to drive when they're not.
Drink driving accounts for 1 in 7 fatalities on all our roads. It is a bigger contributory factor. But fatigue is the biggest killer on major and monotonous roads, accounting for 1 in 5 deaths in the UK.
But how can you avoid it?
Plan your journey. Share the driving if possible. Make sure you don't drink or take drugs or medication that can affect your driving. Don't start a long trip if you're already tired. Try to avoid long trips between 2 a.m. and 6 a.m. and after a heavy lunch.
Plan your route. Include a 15-minute break every 2 hours. Avoid driving for more than 2 hours at both ends of the working day. If necessary, arrange to stay overnight.
During the journey, take your planned rest breaks and keep in touch with traffic news to assess possible delays.
If you start to feel drowsy, find a safe place to stop. If you can, nap for around 15 minutes.
She's allowing the distractions inside the car to affect her concentration. Your reaction times when using a phone are around 55% slower than normal driving, and you are 4 times more likely to crash. This driver is also consulting the sat nav, making the risk even higher.
Even careful drivers can be distracted by a call or text, and a split-second lapse in concentration could result in a crash.
You can avoid the distractions of a mobile phone by following these guidelines.
Make or answer calls when you're driving. All phone calls distract drivers' attention from the road.
Never use a handheld mobile when driving on the road, even if you've stopped at traffic lights or are stuck in a traffic jam. It's illegal.
Park safely before using your mobile phone, not on the hard shoulder.
Don't call other people when they're driving. If you call someone and they tell you they are driving, ask them to call you back when they have parked safely.
If your sat nav is telling you to do something impossible or unlikely, park and consult it in safety.
Here's a quick quiz to assess your knowledge about driving and mobile phones. That's right, well done. As the driver of a vehicle, a car or a motorbike, the only time you're able to use a handheld mobile when driving is in an emergency when it's unsafe to stop.
Here's another question about handheld mobiles. check on your legal obligations. Making sure you have the right insurance.
And finally, do you understand the consequences of using a handheld mobile while you're driving? Immediately lose your license if you are otherwise driving safely. But if your driving is poor or if there is a crash while you're using the phone, you could be prosecuted for more serious charges.
If you are otherwise driving safely, you are likely to get a fixed penalty notice, which means a fine and penalty points. If you already have points on your license, you could risk disqualification.
If you refuse to accept the fixed penalty, you'll be taken to court. In fact, you may also be taken to court if the police think the offence so bad that a fixed penalty is inadequate.
If you go to court, fines will almost certainly be larger and disqualification is possible. Obviously, you must never drive under the influence of alcohol. Drink driving causes a significant percentage of road fatalities every year. If you drive for work, a drink driver
Although the UK has a legal limit for blood alcohol and driving, some jobs and employers have a zero-tolerance policy. Pilots have a rule known as 24 hours from bottle to throttle. Check the guidelines you need to follow. Clearly, the safest thing to do is not drink any alcohol before you drive.
But even if you've never known to drive under the influence, do you know whether you are free from alcohol the morning after having had a drink or two?
Check you understand how much alcohol you're taking in by matching some of these typical alcoholic drinks to their number of units of alcohol. You're right. Did any of these answers surprise you? People are regularly caught out by the number of units in a half bottle of wine. Many restaurants serve large glasses of wine with dinner, and we get used to drinking similar amounts at home.
Once you can calculate the number of units you've consumed, you can estimate whether you are safe to drive. Most people process 1 unit of alcohol per hour. So, if you go to bed at midnight having drunk half a bottle of wine and 4 vodka and tonics in the previous 3 hours, are you safe to drive at 6 the next morning? That's right. Between 9 and 12 p.m., you drank 10.5 units.
Assuming that you process 1 unit of alcohol per hour, you'll have 7.5 units left to process by midnight.
And that means you're not free of alcohol until at least 7:30 in the morning, so you would have to rethink your plans.
A cold shower and a cup of coffee will make absolutely no difference to the levels of alcohol in your blood.
Some other points to remember. Not everyone processes alcohol as quickly as 1 unit per hour. The rate depends on a combination of factors like these. 10.5 units is way over the recommended daily limit.
2 to 3 units a day and no more than 40 per week.
The comfort, power, and ease of driving of today's cars make it difficult to judge your speed. It's very easy to find yourself above the speed limit, but speed kills.
Do trips at these different speeds? Not quite. Double your speed from 20 to 40 miles per hour.
At a high speed, a driver has less time to identify hazards and react to what is happening around them.
How is your reaction time? In this scenario, you're travelling at 30 miles per hour. Click start to begin. At 30 miles per hour, you'd have travelled this far. At 40 miles per hour, it would have increased.
severe.
Of course, it depends on the individual. So, the weather and the condition of the car. But it always takes some time to begin braking when you see a hazard. Speed increases both the thinking distance and the braking distance. A driver traveling at higher speeds will have covered more ground between spotting a hazard and reacting to it. You can see that if you are traveling at 30 miles per hour in a 20 zone, you'll almost double the distance it takes you to stop.
Do you know the national speed limits? What about in built-up areas? That's right. The limit for all vehicles is 30 miles per hour in built-up areas. Remember that local councils can also set their own speed limits in certain areas, for example around schools. These must be clearly defined so you should stay alert.
Speed limits on single carriageways, dual carriageways and motorways vary according to the type of vehicle you drive. Can you fill out this for a car? Can you fill out this for a car? That's right. The limits apply to cars and car-derived vans that weigh a maximum of 2 tons when laden. If you drive a coach, tow a caravan, or drive an HGV, you'll be subject to different limits.
Here are 7 tips to help you avoid speeding.
Before you set out, make sure you know the national speed limit for your vehicle and be alert for local signs.
Plan your journey to ensure you won't feel under time pressure.
On the road, develop a habit of checking your speed regularly, especially when leaving a high-speed road, such as a motorway.
A useful way of keeping within a 30 miles per hour limit is to only go as high as third gear. If you can drive at 30 in third without straining the engine, it will help you to stick to the limit.
Recognize what causes the speed. Feeling under time pressure? Feeling angry? Other drivers? Identify those triggers and make a conscious decision to override them.
Children aren't as aware of traffic as we are, so drive at a speed that allows you to compensate for their lack of judgment. Around schools and in residential areas, 20 is plenty.
Concentrate. Don't let yourself become distracted by what's happening inside the car. It could be kids arguing, conversations, or phone calls.
If you're involved in an accident where someone is hurt, a vehicle or property is damaged, or an animal has been killed, you must
stop, remain at the scene, and call the emergency services if necessary if someone is hurt or the accident is causing a hazard.
Exchange details, name, address, contact numbers, vehicle registration, and the address of the vehicle owner. If someone is injured, you will also need to produce a certificate of insurance.
If you don't exchange particulars at the scene, you must report the accident to the police station within 24 hours of the incident. If you don't, you can be fined, be given penalty points, or even be disqualified.
For your insurance company, you might want to collect other details. For a checklist, click here.
Messages from this section on avoiding accidents are:
don't drive when you're fatigued. Plan your journeys carefully.
Don't let yourself be distracted. Turn off the mobile phone.
Don't drink and drive.
Don't speed. Understand how quickly you can stop and drive well within your limits.
And if unfortunately you do have an accident, make sure you stop and report it.
When you're thinking about a long journey you have to make, which of these conditions makes you most uneasy? Your instincts are on target. A disproportionate number of road traffic accidents occur during the hours of darkness, when there's low visibility, glare from headlights, and your body's preparing for sleep. You may find it more tiring and challenging to drive at night, and so do your fellow road
judge how far away this car is and how fast it is traveling, so that you can make appropriate adjustments to the way you are driving. Very easy to judge distance and speed during the day, but what about at night?
Is it just easy to judge how far away this car is and how fast it is traveling? Evaluate speed and distance accurately at night. The drop in visibility and glare on the windscreen from oncoming headlights makes it harder to see the cues and context that tell you how far away and how fast the object is. It shortens the distance you can actually see, so hazards such as cyclists and pedestrians can seem to appear out of nowhere, and moving from lit to unlit areas makes it hard to adjust. Here are some tips for driving safely at night.
Before you set out, make sure that your lights are as clean and bright as possible, there's no distracting lights in the car, and that you can see clearly through your windscreen.
While you're driving, use your lights appropriately. Use them to see and be seen. Dip your headlights when you're behind another vehicle, or when another vehicle is approaching from the opposite direction. And don't use fog lights unless the conditions merit it.
Drive more carefully and adjust your speed to the current light level.
Wet weather. In Britain, it's a very common adverse condition. Rain affects visibility and it also affects stopping distances because your tyres have less grip on a wet road.
Do you know the maximum speed you could be travelling in order to stop safely in this situation? You're right. More than 20 miles per hour and you would have been involved in an accident. When it's wet, it takes twice the distance to stop safely than when it's dry.
Here are some tips for driving safely when it's wet.
Be proactive. Be more careful around pedestrians, cyclists, motorcyclists and horse riders to keep them safe and to avoid saturating them with spray.
Keep a good safety distance from the vehicle in front, so you've got more time to see and respond to hazards.
Rain and spray from other vehicles make it difficult to see and be seen. Don't assume other drivers can see you.
Don't panic if something goes wrong. If you lose control of your steering, don't snap on the brakes. Slow down gradually by easing off the accelerator until your tires get a grip. People don't take fog as seriously as they should, and don't adapt their driving appropriately. Here's the seasonal story of young Jack and the Beamer. Which parts of the story are good driving practice in fog? You're right, Jack is clearly reckless and doesn't know how to drive in fog. Fortunately, this story has a happy ending, so when the line of traffic all hugging each other's brake lights hit the next patch of fog, which concealed a broken down car, they all managed, after a couple of scary moments, to slow down again.
Accidents that happen in fog can involve a lot of cars. People drive too close to each other and don't have the time to react, or can't see to avoid, and set off a chain reaction. In November 2012, 100 vehicles were involved in a fog accident in Texas. And in November 2011, 52 vehicles crashed in fog in Germany.
Before you undertake to drive in fog, consider very carefully if you need to. If you do, leave a lot of extra time and make sure your lights are working correctly. Lights are the only thing other drivers are likely to see of you. When you hit fog, do what you can to improve visibility.
Put on fog lights, but don't forget to turn them off once the fog has lifted, because they can confuse other drivers. If you can see the car behind you, you should consider turning off your fog lights. Don't use full beam. It doesn't improve visibility for you and dazzles other drivers. Use the windscreen wipers and demister to keep windows as clear as possible.
And do what you can to improve your chances of stopping safely. Slow down. Make sure you can stop in the distance you can see ahead. Don't hug the neck.
other senses. Turn off your radio or music.
A winter safety kit in the car and ensure you are in good condition.
When you're on the road, drive smoothly, adjust your speed to the conditions, keep a good safety distance and use your brakes carefully, and make sure you can be seen.
If you get stuck, call for help and keep warm and safe.
Knowing how to drive appropriately to the conditions makes you a much safer driver.
The key messages on driving in adverse conditions are: be prepared, have safety equipment in the car, be aware of poor visibility. It reduces the information you need to make good decisions and increases your stopping distance. Be aware of slippery surfaces. They also increase your stopping distance.
Remember, it's better to be safe than sorry.
Car. It's also about keeping yourself and your car in tip-top condition. Vehicle defects were a contributing factor in 3% of fatal accidents and 2% of serious accidents, while poor eyesight was involved in 1% of fatal accidents, so you can see it makes sense to keep yourself and your car well-maintained.
To drive legally, you have to meet minimum eyesight requirements. Do you know at what distance you need to be able to read a new style number plate? Can you read a new style number plate from a distance of 20 meters? Definitely is the only right answer to this question. To ensure that you are able to meet the conditions in the highway code, you should have an eye test every 2 years. Of course, eyesight isn't the only consideration. You mustn't drive if you're taking medication that can affect your ability, for example, by making you drowsy, or if you've been advised not to after surgery. Make sure you are fit to drive, and if you are unsure, ask your line manager.
Whether you use your own vehicle for work or use one of ours, you have an obligation to keep your vehicle safe. Click on the button that applies to you. If you drive your own car for work, we will expect you to make sure you meet all the legal requirements for MOT, tax, and insurance. If you're in doubt about the type of insurance you need, discuss it with your line manager.
We'll also expect you to keep your car safe to drive with regular servicing and safety checks, such as tyres, oil, and water.
It's also good practice to keep your vehicle free of hazards, such as empty bottles or dog toys that could roll under the brake, clutch, or accelerator.
We've also included a set of checklists of safety equipment that you can print.
The safety equipment list includes hazard triangles and a high visibility jacket or vest to use if you break down.
The
winter safety equipment list includes a bag of cat litter. To find out why, just click on the link.
That is the meaning of LPD, yes.
LPD?
Yeah, that's correct.
This is the meaning of LPD?
Yes. This is another question from the LPD.
Do they already have this?
No.
To injure your death, because they help to prevent you being thrown about inside or thrown from a vehicle in a collision.
Yes, they will see the website, they will find out what is wrong in fire fighting, how the fire is done, and they will
set the first priority is to make sure your passengers and other drivers are safe. Stay calm and follow these guidelines.
No, they are saying
get your vehicle off road if possible.
Before someone
use hazard warning lights to alert other motorists.
Exit the car
and
wait. Use a reflective jacket, which you should have in the car.
Only use secondary warning devices, such as a red warning triangle, if it is safe to place them.
Make sure pets are safe. Leave windows wide enough for ventilation.
Okay.
Find a safe spot for your passengers.
Call a breakdown service or police if you are causing a hazard.
Follow these guidelines to keep safe. If you break down on a motorway, don't stop on the carriageway unless you absolutely have to. If you have to stop, stop on the hard shoulder and try to get to the next emergency roadside phone.
If you're on the hard shoulder, follow these guidelines to stay safe.
Park as far to the left away from traffic as possible and turn on your vehicle's hazard warning lights. But don't put out your hazard warning triangle.
You and your passengers should leave the vehicle immediately via the left-hand door. Either leave animals in the vehicle or keep them under tight control on the verge.
Contact the highway's agency, preferably using the emergency roadside phone, as this shows your exact location to the operator. Motorway mile markers indicate which direction the nearest phone is in. Never cross a carriageway to get to a phone.
Wait for help to arrive away from the traffic. It's too dangerous to try to repair your car yourself.
If you feel at risk from another person, get back in your vehicle by the left-hand door. Fasten your seatbelt and lock all doors. Leave the vehicle as soon as you feel the risk has passed.
If you are injured or have a disability that means you can't leave the vehicle or get to a roadside phone, the highway code advises you to stay in the vehicle with your seatbelt on. Use your mobile phone to call for help. Switch on your hazard warning lights.
If you can't drive away, use the hard shoulder as an acceleration lane to rejoin the main carriageway.
Jess is leaving her car in this car park, intending to return at 9:45 that evening in the dark. What do you think of her plan? What's unsafe about this situation? Safe involves being aware of your surroundings at all times. What seems safe enough in the light can be quite dangerous at night.
Here, Jess should try to park as close to the lights as possible and as near to the exit or entrance as possible to reduce the time she spends walking alone across a dark car park.
Parking next to an obstruction can make it easier to track you in an unsafe spot. It's also better to reverse into the space so you can drive off immediately.
When you leave your car, try to cover up anything that may attract unwanted attention, expensive items or items that show you may be vulnerable.
It is safer to park in a place where other people are likely to be. This puts off potential attackers and makes it more likely you'll be heard if you do have to cry for help.
If you drive for a living, for example, by making deliveries to multiple addresses every day, all the points about driving safely apply to you. But there's some other factors to keep in mind. After yourself and your car involves.
Make sure you are medically fit to drive.
Ensuring your car is legally up to date.
Carrying out regular safety.